On our quantum journey, we'll experience quantum leaps ourselves from time to time. After all, we're made of particles too, aren't we? And today, with this video, we're taking our first leap together. We're traveling back to the 19th century. I'm going to tell you an amazing story. The story of one of the most extraordinary minds you'll ever encounter in history. Imagine all the developments of the 20th and 21st centuries. The rise of machines in our lives. Household machines. Washing machines, dishwashers, factories. Everything that has shaped our present and will shape our future. Now let me tell you about the man who ignited it all. The man who changed our perspective on matter, nature, light, electricity, and magnetism. The story of Michael Faraday. Beyond his inventions and discoveries, his life story alone is one we should all look up to. A story that can inspire all youth, all of humanity, because he truly started from zero, in every sense of the word. That's why, before getting into the technical details, let's talk about where Faraday came from. Born in London in 1791, Faraday began life on the losing side. His father worked alongside a blacksmith, and their lives were tough. When Faraday reached school age, he started school, but he wasn't a top student, and he also needed to make money. Moreover, due to his struggles and slow learning, his teachers treated him quite poorly. As a result, he was withdrawn from school before even completing his basic education. This incident, which may seem sad, would perhaps lead to significant developments for both Faraday and us. After leaving school, Faraday started working in various jobs. At the age of 14, he began working as an apprentice at the bookbinding and bookstore shop owned by George Rebo, helping to bind books. What if I told you that a boy starting an apprenticeship at a bookstore to make a living would change the course of human history? This is perhaps one of the best examples of the butterfly effect. In this bookstore, while binding books, Faraday began glancing at the pages of the books he worked on. A sentence, a paragraph. Soon he became almost addicted to reading. He would first bind the books, then read them, all of them. Whatever he found, he couldn't stop. He kept reading. History, alchemy, literature, poetry. But he was most interested in books about physics and chemistry. The more he read, the more his curiosity grew. Two books, in particular, would be of great importance to him. The first was The Improvement of the Mind by Isaac Watt. This book discusses the dangers of dogmas and clichés, the importance of critical thinking, and why one should question things. Faraday read this book countless times and applied everything he learned to his own life. Faraday, who began thinking more critically, was also deeply impacted by another book, Conversations on Chemistry, by Jane Marcet. This book was a set of notes taken by Jane Marcet from public lectures on chemistry by a prominent scientist, describing the processes and outcomes of the experiments. Excited by these ideas, Faraday even bought materials with his own money to try some of these experiments at home. He worked at the bookstore for about 7 years, reading countless books. Then, one day, his life would change when a customer handed him a ticket. It was an entry ticket to a conference attended by London's elite. And this conference was one where experiments from the book we just mentioned were demonstrated, the chemistry lectures of Sir Humphry Davy. Scientific public lectures back then were a huge source of entertainment, much like today's most popular shows. Scientists, experimental physicists, and chemists would take the stage to discuss their theories and perform experiments. For many, it was just an evening's entertainment. But for Faraday, these shows were very important. There was one problem, though Faraday wasn't from an upper-class family. He didn't even have proper clothes, and when he attended these lectures, the aristocrats looked at him strangely, making him feel quite out of place. But he attended anyway. His curiosity helped him overlook class distinctions. Faraday attended every lecture, meticulously noting down every word Sir Humphry Davy said. While everyone else watched and applauded, Faraday's eyes sparkled with excitement. By the end of this lecture series, he combined his notes with his own insights, creating the 300-page book. I want to remind you again, this man, who was dismissed in primary school for learning slowly, who was scolded and couldn't even finish school, was poor and had to work to survive. Faraday, despite all of this, attended chemistry and physics lectures, took notes, and developed himself without any external help, without making a single penny, driven solely by his curiosity. Despite the challenges posed by class distinctions, he compiled his notes into a book and sent it as a gift to Sir Humphrey Davy. Shortly after, something happened that would be unfortunate for Davy, but life-changing for Faraday. Davy was injured in an experiment explosion, temporarily losing his ability to see and write. He needed help. When looking for an assistant, he turned to the young man who had compiled such successful notes on his lectures. Faraday worked as Davy's assistant for a short time until Davy recovered. Afterward, Faraday reluctantly returned to bookbinding. But soon, when Davy's main assistant was dismissed, Davy offered Faraday an official position as a chemical experiment assistant. Would he accept this offer? Was that even a question? Working at the Royal Institution, a place dedicated to scientific research and development, where renowned scientists conducted incredible research, was an offer he couldn't refuse. So, our bookbinding apprentice began working at the Royal Institution. And even better, he was now doing what he loved most, working with science. The date was March 1, 1813, and he was just 21 years old. Just 8 months later, he would accompany Davy as his assistant on an 18-month European tour, where he would meet some of the greatest scientists of his time, like André Marie Ampère and Alessandro Volta. However, poverty wouldn't leave him alone. Davy's wife wasn't too happy about bringing this non-aristocratic young man along, and she kept putting him down, reminding him of his humble origins. During this time, Faraday seriously considered leaving everything behind and returning to his modest life. But the conversations he had with Volta and Ampère had already ignited an unquenchable spark in his mind. Around this time, electricity had become one of the hottest topics of the century. Everyone was doing research on electricity, trying to understand this strange force. But there was a big problem. Everyone believed the forces in nature were independent, separate from one another. No one had yet discovered a connection between them. However, our bookbinding apprentice was about to change everything. His meeting with Alessandro Volta, as we mentioned earlier, would prove significant. Volta had recently invented the battery, creating a revolution. Today, we understand the origin of the unit of volt from this. Everyone was experimenting with this invention, including Davy. He and Faraday were conducting numerous experiments in the lab, trying to understand this strange force, just like everyone else. At that time, a remarkable discovery was made. Up until then, everyone was certain that electricity flowed as a current through wires. However, a Danish physicist named Hans Christian Ørsted discovered by accident that electric currents affected the direction of a compass needle. This was baffling. How could something flowing within a wire influence something it didn't even touch? Ørsted found this experimentally but couldn't explain it. Yet, this discovery would change everything. Faraday, who constantly had his hands on new material, also came across Ørsted's publication on this experiment. And that's when the pieces began to fall into place. Faraday wasn't alone. Influential figures like André Marie Ampère, Pierre Simon Laplace, and Dominique Francois Jang, Arago were leading a new era of discoveries in the early 1800s. Those who interpreted Ørsted's discovery correctly would make a mark on this era. Faraday, inspired by this discovery, proposed the idea that electricity must create a magnetic field. He conducted several more experiments and found that this magnetic field was circular in shape. He discovered this by placing a few compasses around an electric wire. The questions didn't stop there. Like a child with a new toy, he tried everything. Eventually, he conducted his famous mercury experiment. If electricity created a magnetic field, would a magnet follow this field? He placed a magnet south pole fixed in a bowl of mercury with its north pole exposed at the surface. Then, he inserted a wire into the bowl, applied an electric current, and saw that he was correct. The magnet began rotating around the wire. Then he tried the reverse, leaving the magnet stationary and letting the wire move freely. The result was the same. This time, the wire rotated around the magnet. Do you know what Faraday had discovered? He had created the world's first electric motor, a device that converted electrical energy into mechanical energy. This was the first draft of an incredible invention that would provide energy for all humankind. More importantly, it demonstrated that electricity and magnetism were connected, forming what we now call electromagnetism. Until then, these forces were thought to be unrelated. Faraday had done what an upper-class scientist should have done. He had simplified it. In the following decade, Faraday carried out various experiments, and his invention was quickly developed by other scientists, making electric motors increasingly practical. But Faraday's work with electricity wasn't over. In his correspondence with Ampere, Ampere suggested that a coiled wire could also act as a magnet. Inspired by this, Faraday conducted hundreds of experiments. For months, he pondered this, leaving no stone unturned. The question he was trying to answer was, if an electric field created a magnetic field, couldn't a magnetic field create electricity? After many failed attempts, he arranged two coils so that one coil could transfer current to the other without any physical contact. When he applied current to the first coil, he observed a movement in the compass he used to measure. It was weak and brief. The compass moved only when he started or stopped the current, then returned to its original position. There was only one explanation. Once the magnetic field stabilized, the compass no longer moved. To solve this, he came up with a simple yet brilliant solution. He moved the magnet back and forth within the coil and noticed that the compass needle moved with each movement. This phenomenon, known as magnetic induction, was essentially this. However, he still faced a problem. The effect was momentary. He wanted to make it continuous. To achieve this, he built a larger mechanism and used a conductive disc, which he rotated to make the current continuous. In October 1831, he conducted this experiment, which became perhaps Faraday's most important achievement. He managed to create a continuous electric current with a machine. This was humanity's first dynamo. In my view, it was one of the most significant discoveries in human history. Over the next few years, many scientists, including Edison, would develop this invention. Why was this so important? Because this discovery formed the basis for all modern-day power plants, dams, generators, transformers, and converters. Everything that powers humanity. Thanks to this discovery, which could generate currents of various levels for different purposes, televisions and computers would eventually come to life. The transformers used in electronics are based on Faraday's discovery of what he called the induction ring. Of course, all the devices I mentioned were separate discoveries by other brilliant individuals, but all of them, every one, were based on the discoveries of a man who tinkered alone in his small lab. He was a spark that turned into a fire. Was that all? Of course not. Faraday achieved many remarkable things, both large and small. For instance, through what we now call Faraday's laws of electrolysis, he laid the foundation for the production and processing of critical raw materials in electrochemical industries. The principles of lithium-ion batteries are also based on these laws. If you're watching this video on your phone, he's the one to thank. Aside from this, he was one of the first to achieve the liquefaction of gas, which set the groundwork for modern refrigerators. He also discovered benzene, a critical substance in chemistry. He invented the Faraday cage, which not only protects against electric shocks, but also creates an electromagnetic dead zone, even blocking mobile signals. However, One of his most groundbreaking ideas was about light. Faraday proposed a radical idea that electricity emitted invisible light, and that everything, even the sun, emitted some form of light we couldn't see. He suggested that light itself was a type of electromagnetic wave. Despite all his discoveries, no one took his crazy theory seriously. Nobody believed it was possible. He, too, couldn't prove it. For a reason. On the other hand, our bookbinding apprentice, who hadn't even finished primary school, was now a professor at the Royal Institution. The same institution where he had once been a mere spectator, where he'd been treated as an outsider because of his social class, where nobody believed in him as a young boy. Yet here he was, as a professor. This wasn't easy, of course. Initially, his former mentor Sir Humphrey Davy held a grudge against him. The student had surpassed the master. Davy accused him of various things and tried to hinder his work, refusing to publish his research. He tried to place obstacles in Faraday's path at every turn, but he couldn't stop him. After Davy's passing, the young man who had once listened to him began giving lectures at the Royal Institution in his place. An incredible story indeed. But there's something important to mention here. Despite all his success, we must recognize the importance of quality education. Faraday was an experimental physicist. There were also theoretical physicists. Faraday didn't work much with formulas or theories. He conducted experiments and reached conclusions. And as we can see, he may have been the best in history at it. But sometimes, you also need to be able to explain your findings to connect the dots well. For example, when you say, light is an electromagnetic wave, you need to be able to prove it. At this point, Faraday was, let's say, lacking. That is, until another brilliant mind, a young man who believed in Faraday, who would fill in the gaps, build on Faraday's work, and change the world just as radically as Faraday, came onto the scene. Even more influential than Faraday, even reaching the depth of influence of Einstein and Newton. James Clerk Maxwell. I think you can now understand why I decided to talk about these names before diving into quantum physics, time travel, quantum gravity, or string theory. Because these names, these theories, these discoveries, you'll eventually understand they're all interconnected. Each one is like a brick stacked upon the other, taking us closer to the theory of everything we will eventually discuss. We've talked at length about Tesla too, but there were still things we left out. We'll come back to those as well. So our journey continues. Stick around. And as always, until we meet again, you're appreciated. Take care. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe for more content like this. And remember, you are valuable.